but no deer, like Prospect Park. Duke Wasser guesses that birds and small mammals may have brought those ticks.
So, Rosemary, what are the risks from city ticks?
There are four varieties of ticks, but the one that's a really big concern is the black-legged tick because it carries six different pathogens, including Lyme disease. And the tick threat is year-round, but it's at its worst from May to July. There are other diseases that you can get from ticks, like there's a meat allergy that develops from some tick bites. And the threat is very real in the five boroughs because in 2000, they reported about 215 tick-borne diseases. And last year, the cases were 16 times that amount, according to the city's Department of Health. But also, it's very hard to tell if somebody was bitten in New York City or they were up in the Catskills for a weekend and got bitten there.
So, what are some precautions we can take?
Well, I got some advice from Maria Duke Wasser, the ecologist that's studying ticks at Columbia University, and she had this advice for nature-loving New Yorkers.
If it's a very manicured park, just lawn, I would say you're relatively safe. But if you go to a more forested park, you would take the usual precautions against ticks, wear long pants and, socks over the pants. You can spray yourself with DEET.
She also advises right after you take a walk in the park or in your yard that might be near a park, do a tick check. And when you get home, remove all your clothes and wash them, and then take a shower.
So let's say you find a tick. What do you do then?
Remove it as soon as possible. They usually advise to use tweezers. And if you can get it off within 24 to 36 hours, you'll be fine. And you should also see your doctor. Then you can take care of this before it escalates. If you do get a tick, you can report it on the tick app, which is run by Columbia University, and it can help you identify the tick that you have been bitten by.
All good advice from WNYC's Rosemary Mizderi. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
WNYC supporters include New Jersey Symphony presenting The Godfather live in concert. This concert features the symphony performing Nino Rota's score live to picture on a large HD screen, August 16th and 18th in Newark and Red Bank. Tickets at njsymphony.org. Sponsoring WNYC means reaching hundreds of thousands of engaged and discerning listeners who've made our shows part of their daily routine. Find more on sharing your business message with WNYC's unique audience at wnyc.org/sponsorship.
On the next Brian Lehrer Show, we continue our WNYC Centennial Series, 100 Years of 100 Things. It's thing number 9, 100-year history of New York City pizza. Also, journalist Charlie Locke about her piece in The Atlantic, Retirement Gets Harder the Longer You Wait. The Brian Lehrer Show, weekdays at 10 a.m. on WNYC.
Marketplace Morning Report is coming up next, and then in 10 minutes at 9 o'clock, it's the BBC News Hour on WNYC. Let's check in with London to see what they're working on. Good morning, London.
Good morning, WNYC. I'm Rebecca Kesby, and on today's programme, in Bangladesh, long-serving Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina has resigned amid huge protests. She's left the country via helicopter as thousands have been storming her official residence, and record falls on the Japanese stock market triggered by concerns over the US economy. That's BBC NewsHour coming up at 9 on WNYC.
We'll see sunny skies for this back to work Monday with a slight chance of a shower or thunderstorm later on this afternoon and highs in the upper 80s. Partly cloudy tonight. We could see a shower in the evening and then mostly cloudy after midnight with lows around 70. Right now it's sunny and 79 degrees in New York City. The Marketplace Morning Report coming up next.
Earth. early August 2024 when stocks hit the skids. So far this morning, the selling continues with Dow futures down more than 1,000 points or 2.8%.
Marketplace Morning Report is supported by Progressive Insurance. The Name Your Price tool provides a range of coverage options. Progressive.com. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
I'm David Brancaccio. U.S. stock index futures are pointing to another sharply down day in the U.S. amid worries the downturn that the U.S. Federal Reserve has engineered might lead not to a soft landing, but perhaps to a recession. S&P futures are down 2.8% and NASDAQ futures are currently down 5.3%. If that drop holds, for some perspective, that puts the NASDAQ index down to where it was just in mid-June. Meanwhile, European indicators are down sharply, with London and Frankfurt down between 3 and 3.5%. In the U.S., the VIX index of stock volatility is at its highest level since the March 2020 pandemic lockdown. Marketplace's Nova Safo has more.
The Federal Reserve signaled last week that it was poised to cut interest rates in September, ending a more than two-year tightening cycle. At first, investors were cheered, but then came last week's jobs report. The unemployment rate had risen nearly an entire percentage point compared to its recent low. There's some debate whether the report includes some statistical noise, but still, the labor market is not the juggernaut it was at the beginning of the year. Stocks plunged.
The root of all of this is markets increasingly coming around to the view that the Fed has been too slow to recognize that they need to cut rates.
Ian Shepherdson of Pantheon Macroeconomics says there's concern that unless there are substantial interest rate cuts soon, inflation could fall too low and spending could decline at the same time. This isn't happening now, and there's no imminent risk of recession, says Daniela Hathorn, senior market analyst at Capital.com.
We've seen clear recession signals for over 2 years now, and nothing's happened. The economy's been resilient. So it doesn't necessarily mean that this is doomsday and we're in the thick of it.
But fears can feed a market correction, which itself can feed a recession. We're not there yet. The current downturn does not measure up to what we saw in 2020, 2008, or the bursting dot-com bubble of the early 2000s. I'm Nova Safo for Marketplace.
Money is going into U.S. government bonds today, both as a safe haven amid the stock turbulence and an expectation of a slowing U.S. economy. The 10-year interest rate down sharply, 3.68%. That's the lowest since the spring of last year. Now, the most dramatic sell-off today so far is Japan, where the Nikkei index closed down 13%, its deepest drop since the 1987 stock market crash. Mariko Oi, with our newsroom partners at the BBC, is following this from Singapore. She says it's partly about Japanese interest rates going up as U.S. rates seem headed down.
The Bank of Japan last Wednesday raised the cost of borrowing 0.25%, which sounds very low compared to the rest of the world. But the whole point was they were trying to prop up the value of the Japanese yen, because the Japanese currency has been falling sharply against the US dollar, and it was making the cost of imports for things like fuel and food more expensive. Also, of course, last Friday, we had a very weak US jobs data coming out, and that started concerns among some investors that the world's biggest economy could be headed for a recession.
Dow futures are down again 1,200 points, 2.9%. NASDAQ futures are down more than 1,000 points, 5.4%.
Marketplace Morning Report is supported by The Economist, devoted to providing independent journalism that makes sense of the news shaping the world. More at economist.com or with The Economist app, newsletters, and podcasts. And by Amazon Business, focused on offering smart business buying solutions, leaving time to focus on growth. More at amazonbusiness.com.
Even though inflation is easing, prices are still high for many things like groceries, suspiciously high according to the Biden administration. Federal Trade Commission Chair Lina Khan says the agency has started an investigation into grocery prices to see if they're not inflation but gouging. Here's Marketplace's Kimberly Adams.
The sticker shock many of us are experiencing at the grocery store caught the attention of federal regulators, and not just because cereal is more expensive.
Grocery prices have been running much higher than average inflation, and grocery profit margins have been quite high as well.
Lindsay Owens is executive director of the Washington think tank Groundwork Collaborative.
And while the input costs come down, grocery prices are still high, and that's been a problem for many families who are trying to keep food on the table.
Grocery stores and food producers have said higher costs of labor and supply chain disruptions have been keeping prices high. And as for the profits, well, it's not illegal for a company to make money. In fact, shareholders demand it. Rick Chakraborty teaches economics at Christopher Newport University in Virginia.
So the FTC's job, if anything, is to convince us that there is something else going on. So, for example, maybe big companies are somehow colluding among themselves and they're fixing prices.
That kind of behavior is illegal. Another avenue for the FTC to explore is whether market concentration is to blame. Luis Cabral is an economics professor at NYU's Stern School of Business.
If, for example, there's through mergers and acquisitions a considerable concentration of sellers, then the market may no longer be competitive.
If there's only one or two grocery stores in an area, they can kind of set whatever prices they want. And it would be one thing if the concentration and high profits were in a sector like luxury goods, says Caitlin Caruso, who teaches at the University of Maine School of Law. But when it comes to food,
people don't like the idea that their unexpected vulnerability is being taken advantage of.
Caruso says the line between pricing responsive to market conditions and price gouging isn't always clear. Dozens of states have laws against it, but
many economists will tell you that anti-gouging laws are wrong-headed and bad for the market, and yet they are very popular and increasing in number rather than decreasing. Because I think there's some element of partially moral regulation going on there.
But a moral argument may not be enough for the government to step in. For that, the FTC will likely need an economic argument as well. In Washington, I'm Kimberly Adams for Marketplace.
And amid the stock mess, while bonds have been a haven, the same cannot be said for crypto. For instance, the Bitcoin market lost $270 billion in value on Sunday alone. Bitcoin is down 22% since midday Friday as investors move out of riskier assets during this uncertain moment for stocks. I'm David Brancaccio, Marketplace Morning Report. From APM, American Public Media.
Support for WNYC comes from